Now, each year, the World Economic Forum recognises 21 brilliant young researchers for their contribution to advancing the frontiers of science. Well, this year, more than half are women, and one of them is Ruth Morgan, whose research questions the reliability of something used every day in courts around the world to decide guilt or innocence, and that is forensic evidence. Well, she is the director of the UCL Centre for Forensic Sciences, and she joins me here in the studio. Ruth Morgan, welcome here to the programme, and congratulations for being one of the 21. Just tell me a little of how you actually got involved in this sort of area.
I think this is an area where I was doing some research and I was working on a case, and it became apparent that there was some evidence that was presented in court as a fact. And when we started to look into that from a scientific point of view, we were able to see that those facts actually didn't have an evidential base and they were actually assumptions. And that was what the case rested on, and we were able to show that.
And that started a body of work for you. For a lot of lay people watching something like this and watching what happens in courts and what they see on television, I mean, they think that forensic evidence is pretty infallible. It's almost like a slam dunk. Is it as robust? Is it as reliable as people think?
It's definitely very robust. In some ways, it's a technological success story. So we can now detect smaller and smaller amounts of trace material more and more quickly, more and more accurately than ever before. We can collect more data and search it better than ever before. But what we are facing is this systemic issue that affects every form of evidence, which is that when we find it, we don't always know what it means. And that's what we're searching the answers for.
Tell me a little more about what you mean by that, because it's not just trace evidence that you were talking about. I think it covers DNA, it covers explosive residue. What is potentially going wrong here?
I think the scenario is, if we find gunshot residue on your jacket or maybe your DNA on a gun, we are very good at being able to detect that that is gunshot residue or that is definitely your DNA, but we need to know, what does it mean? Did you fire the gun? And that's what we don't always have the answers for.
I was struck by one statistic I read today, which was from 2015, and it was from the FBI, that identified that in 96% of cases where hair analysis was critical in a case, that the evidence had been overstated or misrepresentative. I mean, that is a staggering statistic. Again, in this area, what is going wrong, do you think?
I think it comes down to having an evidence base. So we are able to detect, but we don't always know how that evidence is engaging in the environment. When does it transfer? When does it persist? And so when we are finding it, we are not able to sufficiently identify whether that means it transferred during a crime event or whether it may be transferred earlier in the day or maybe last week.
Is part of the problem the quality of the forensic scientists?
We've got wonderful forensic scientists in the UK. I think UK is actually leading very much so in the world in terms of the quality and the processes that we have in place. I think this is more a case of needing to be able to understand the activities around the evidence. So not simply detecting, which we are very, very good at and we are very, very clearly world leading at, but it is, how do we understand how it got there?
So tell me more about that, because that's what you've been recognised for with this award, being part of the 21. What is the work that you're doing that actually reduces the risk of making a mistake in all of those areas that I've touched upon?
So we're looking at two areas. We're looking at the evidence itself, and we're looking at the decisions that are being made by people at critical parts of that process, from the crime scene through to the court. So one example around the evidence would be the work that we're leading in trace DNA, so people call it touch DNA. And we're showing that there are certain circumstances when, if you use a knife, you will leave your DNA on that knife. But there are other times when, if you perhaps shake hands with somebody before you then go on to use the knife, that you can deposit their DNA on that knife. So that ends up being a knife with DNA on it from somebody who's never touched it. So understanding when that happens, how that happens, that will enable us to be much more robust about understanding what it means when we find that DNA on a gun or on a knife.
Well, Ruth Morgan, it's been fascinating talking to you. Thanks so much for coming in and just going through all of that for us. Thanks.